Hello folks, welcome back to the SFOAM channel and thanks for tuning in. In this particular video I will discuss 7 steps that will help you to start your astrophotography hobby. So without further ado, let's get into it. If you're new to my channel, my name is Wido Oerlemans and I'm an amateur astrophotographer living in Utrecht, the Netherlands, where I perform my astrophotography. And on my channel I share equipment reviews and tutorials that will hopefully also help you to improve your own astrophotography skills. If you like this kind of content, please consider subscribing to my channel by clicking on the button on the bottom right of the screen. I would highly appreciate that. And now that's out of the way, let's move on with the video. So hi folks. This video is specifically meant for those of you who are thinking about starting their astrophotography hobby. And I will mention 7 tips that I wished I would have known 5 years ago when I first started out my astrophotography hobby. That would have saved me a lot of mistakes. And the first 4 tips will basically be about the astrophotography gear that you would need to start this hobby. And the final 3 tips will be about the skills and also the software you would need to actually go outside, set up your equipment and take a beautiful picture of an object that is out there in deep space. We call that a deep sky object. And of course, these are just my personal thoughts and my personal opinions. I'm just a dude talking about astrophotography on the internet. So if you have any kind of comments or you want to add to this video, please don't hesitate to put your comments below in the comment section. I'm always happy to get into a conversation with you. And without further ado, let's get into that first step or tip. First tip. So hi folks, the first tip I want to give you when starting your astrophotography hobby is to look for an equatorial mount. So you need a telescope mount, obviously. So a mount is just a thing where you can put your telescope and your camera on. So this is a mount. And what you need to buy is a German equatorial mount, or in short, an equatorial mount. So you have to take care. There are 2 types of mounts basically out there on the astrophotography market. An Alt-S mount or an altitude azimuth mount and an equatorial mount. So buy the equatorial mount because this type of mount, you can align that mount to either the north celestial pole when you are in the northern hemisphere or the south celestial pole when you are in the southern hemisphere. And basically I will get into this more later on in the video, but this polar alignment of the mount will enable you to accurately track the stars for multiple minutes in the night sky, and it will enable you to take long exposure pictures. So what kind of things should you look for when buying like a beginner level equatorial mount for astrophotography? I would say 3 things. So the first thing I would look for is the maximum payload capacity, and I would advise you to buy a beginner level mount that can carry at least up to 10 kgs, 10 kilograms, or about 22 pounds when you live in the USA. I would say when you start out doing astrophotography, you will need a telescope, a camera, some tracking gear. I will get into that later on in the video. But actually, this already weighs about 5 kilograms if you buy relatively lightweight material. And you don't want to push the telescope mount to its limit. So you want maybe to put a payload on the mount that is about 50% of the maximum payload capacity of that mount. So again, I would advise you to buy a beginner level mount that can carry at least 10 kilograms or 22 pounds. The second thing to look for when buying an equatorial mount is it has to have an auto-guiding option. And I will get also into that later on in the video, but auto-guiding will enable you to accurately track deep sky objects in the night sky for multiple minutes, and you need that to take long exposure pictures of your target. So check if the equatorial mount has this auto-guiding option. If it does not have auto-guiding, don't buy it. And then the third thing you want to check for is whether or not your mount can actually be connected to a PC or a laptop. Because yeah, that enables you to like update the software on the mount, and also yeah, it lets the computer and the software on your computer to talk to the mount, which will increase the accuracy of that mount. So look out for that. So three things: maximum payload capacity 10 kgs, it has to have an auto guiding option, and it has to be able to connect to your PC or laptop. For instance, this is a Celestron Advanced VX mount. I have a video on that. This is a typical beginner level astrophotography mount. You can connect that mount via the hand controller. In this case, it has like this output. You can connect it to your PC. And I would say, yeah, the Celestron Advanced VX is one of those mounts that you can consider when starting your astrophotography hobby. So I will put a link to these videos on my Celestron AVX in the description below. And yeah, let's move on with the second tip. So hi folks. The second thing, of course, that is very important when starting your astrophotography hobby is to buy, yeah, the right kind of telescope. And of course, there's a lot of debate on this, and actually I have made an entire video on what I think is a good quality, affordable telescope to start your astrophotography hobby with. So I'll put a link here in the video, in the card of the video, and also in the description down below, so you can check that video out. But a long story short, I would recommend you to buy a refractor when first starting your astrophotography hobby. And more specifically, I would advise you to buy either an extra low dispersion glass doublet or an ED doublet type of refractor, or even more perfect, if you have the money, buy an APO triplet refractor. And why do I mention these two types of refractors? Well, they have several advantages, so I will mention a couple here. First of all, you can see I'm carrying here a triplet, an APO triplet refractor. They are so lightweight, I can even throw them in the air, maybe not very good to do. So they are easy to carry around, easy to set up. You can just engage in your hobby without breaking your back. So that's very important. They are lightweight. The second thing is they will produce a relatively wide field picture and also a high quality picture of the deep sky objects that you are interested in. So for instance, a refractor is perfectly suited to image some of the larger nebula. So the Orion Nebula, the Horsehead Nebula, the Rosette Nebula, and also for instance, the famous Andromeda Galaxy. It's pretty large in your field of view. This wide field refractor is able to take to give you a nice image of those kind of objects. And also, a wide field refractor means that you, when you first start out using your German equatorial mount for tracking, this can be very challenging. And there will be some variation in the accuracy with which you can track those objects. And then a wide field refractor such as this one is relatively forgiving. You can have some variation in the accuracy of your tracking, and then you will still get a good quality picture of your deep sky object. So nice round stars, for instance, in your picture. So I would say, yeah, also very nice in this refractor. And then the third thing I like in a refractor is that it doesn't require any maintenance. So yeah, some of us of course like to tinker a little bit, and they like maintaining their telescope, but I would say when you just start out your astrophotography hobby, you want a telescope that is ready to go, doesn't require any maintenance, and you can just put it on your mount and engage in your astrophotography hobby. And a refractor, an APO triplet refractor or an ED doublet refractor will allow you to do that. So again, check out my videos on my video on affordable telescopes, and let's move on to the third tip. The third tip I want to give you is to buy some decent tracking gear. And what is tracking gear? Well, basically it's not so difficult to understand. I have my tracking gear right with me here. So I'm basically talking about a small telescope. So this is a 50 millimeter Orion guide scope. It only costs about 80 euros or $80, so it doesn't break the bank. And I have here a small camera, and this camera is a ZWO 120 MC in my case. I don't know if you can see it. And very important, this camera has to have auto guiding option. And by the way, this camera is also about, I think, $140 or euro. So it really doesn't break the bank in terms of cost. And what it will do is, you can mount this tracking gear on either your mount or your telescope. So I will show you here. I'm just putting my tracking gear here on my telescope. And what it then does is, I can focus this telescope on a specific star in the night sky, and then this telescope and this camera will track that star in the night sky. And when it notices that the star moves a little bit to the left or the right or up or down, it will send corrections from like the auto guide port of the camera to the mount. So it will tell your mount to maybe go a little bit up or down or left or right in order to increase the accuracy of your guiding. And that is the most important thing, because these beginner level mounts, I think without tracking gear, they are maybe able to track accurately for about 30 to 60 seconds, so maybe up to 1 minute. But with tracking gear, you can guide your mount for up to multiple minutes. And that really enables you to take longer exposure pictures of your astronomical objects that you want to image. And you have to think about all that faint light that comes from space. If you have more minutes to capture that faint light, then this picture will be more pronounced, and you will get a higher quality picture and more details, a more detailed picture of the astronomical object that you want to image. So my third tip is, buy some tracking gear. And let's move on to the fourth tip. The fourth tip will be about the right kind of camera that you can buy to start your astrophotography hobby. And actually, I have made an entire video on this, on depending on your personal interests and your situation, you might want to go for different types of cameras. So I will put a link to that video in the description here, or on the card here, and in the description below this video. But basically, a long story short, I would say, if you're just starting your astrophotography hobby and you have a DSLR already, a DSLR camera for your daytime astrophotography, I would say just start using your DSLR for astrophotography as well. This is my Canon 1200D. I started out with this camera, and basically what you can do, you can just take off the lens, and you have some adapter ring you can use. They are very cheap, maybe 15 to 20 bucks. For Canon, Nikon, Sony, any type of DSLR you might have. And you can connect then this adapter ring to the camera, and this adapter ring can then be connected to your telescope. So you can just put your telescope and your camera, you connect them together. And that will basically allow you to start your astrophotography with your DSLR. And There are a lot of software programs out there, so you can connect your DSLR to your laptop or desktop, and that will allow you to take your images with dedicated software for astrophotography. I will get into that later on. If you still want a dedicated astrophotography camera, you have to take into account the two main differences. So first, we have mono cameras versus color cameras. And the thing you need to remember is, when you buy a mono camera, this will produce a higher quality image of your astrophotography picture. But I would say, when you just start out doing astrophotography, buy a color camera, because it is especially the capturing and the post-processing process is a lot easier when you just start out with a color camera as compared to starting out with a mono camera. It saves you a lot of steps that you would need to learn. And also, when you are interested in deep sky astrophotography, I would highly recommend you to buy a dedicated camera. If you want to buy a dedicated astrophotography camera, you want to buy a camera that has cooling. So you can see here this big thing in on the back. It's actually a Peltier cooler, and this allows your sensor of your camera to cool down to, for instance, minus 40 Celsius below ambient temperature. So I always cool this to about minus 20 degrees Celsius. And this saves you a lot of noise in your picture when you take multi-minute pictures of your astronomical objects. So that's basically what I wanted to say about the camera. So please check out also a link to my video on what kind of camera would be best suited for you to start your astrophotography hobby. And let's move on to the fifth tip. Hi folks, question of the day. What kind of astrophotography equipment are you considering to buy to start your astrophotography hobby? Please let me know in the comment section down below. Or maybe you already are into astrophotography, then maybe you can share what kind of astrophotography equipment you started out with when first engaging in our beautiful hobby of astrophotography. Please let me know in the comment section down below and we can share our experiences together. The fifth tip will then be you have to learn how to set up and to polar align and to star align your German equatorial mount. And actually I have made some dedicated videos on that, so you can find it here in one of the cards and also in the description down below. So yeah, this fifth step, let's get into that a little bit. So the things you need to remember is, actually I will mention the skills that you need to develop. So first of all, you need to polar align your mount. And you have to do that in several steps. So first of all, when you're in the northern hemisphere, you have to point your tripod due north. Or when you are in the southern hemisphere, you have to point your tripod to the south. And then you put your mount on the tripod, your mount head on the tripod. And what is also very important there is that you level your mount. So when your mount is a little bit unleveled, then the tracking of your German equatorial mounts of the stars will not be very accurate. So leveling your mount is a very important thing. Also, yeah, the polar alignment has to be correct. So you have to put your mount into the correct latitude position. And of course you have then to engage in what is called polar alignment. It will take too much time to get into that. So please check out my dedicated video on polar alignment. And then finally, when you have polar aligned your mount, you can also get into a procedure that is called star alignment. So you can use your hand controller, you can set up your hand controller to have the correct time, the correct location where you are at on Earth, and then you can also put some information on where the stars are in the night sky, and your German equatorial mount will use that information to increase the accuracy actually of the tracking of the mount. I have made all those kind of videos, dedicated videos on all these steps. So please check out these videos if you're interested in learning how to do that. And let's move on to the sixth step. So hi folks, the sixth tip is all about learning how to accurately track and how to accurately capture your images of those deep sky objects. And actually, a lot of amateur astrophotographers use all kinds of software programs for that. So I will mention a few of those programs here in this section of the video. So first of all, 99.9%, I would say, of all amateur astrophotographers, they use PhD2 Guiding. It's a software program, you can download it for free on your laptop or your desktop, and it enables you to really accurately track objects in the night sky. And you have to learn how to work with PhD2 Guiding. And I will not get into details right now, but there's a lot of information available. So just Google PhD2 Guiding or look at one of the videos that are out there and you will see what I mean. What PhD2 Guiding does in very broad strokes is you have your tracking camera, you can connect that camera to PhD2 software, and also you can connect your German equatorial mount to PhD2, and then PhD2 starts tracking a specific star in the night sky. It will focus on that star, and every time when the star moves a little bit to the left or the right or up or down, it will send corrections to your German equatorial mount. And that really allows you to have a more accurate tracking of your deep sky object, so that you can take multi-minute long exposure pictures, and that leads to better results basically. So I would say here, Use PhD2 guiding. Learn how to use PhD2 guiding. And the second thing about capturing is similar. So a lot of astrophotography or amateur astrophotographers, they use a lot of different software that is available out there on the, sometimes freely available, sometimes you have to pay a little bit, to actually capture the images that they are interested in. So when you are focused on the deep sky object that you want to image, most of the astrophotographers, they connect their camera, so you can see here there's a USB connection. Also when you use your DSLR camera, there's always a micro USB output on your DSLR. And you connect that camera with a USB cable to your computer. And basically, there's a lot of software out there. So for, I remember then when I first started out capturing, I used Backyard EOS. I have a specific video on how to use Backyard EOS software. It is also available for Nikon types of cameras. And this is really a user-friendly tool. It has a user-friendly design, I would say, which allows you to set the gain of your camera, so the ISO setting basically, how to set the exposure time, and actually how to create a sequence. And what I mean by that is you are going to take maybe 10, 20, 30, 40 pictures, long exposure pictures, of your astronomical object, because the light that is coming from deep sky objects, it is so faint that you need maybe 1 or 2 or 3 hours of exposure time, or maybe even more, to actually capture that object. And then you will go, you will put all of those pictures together. I will get into that in the seventh and final step. But actually, Backyard EOS is such a very user-friendly software tool that a lot of people use. Another often used tool to capture your images is astrophotography tool. So also look for astrophotography tool. It has a lot of capabilities. I never used it myself, but I see a lot of other people using it. And then finally, if you want a little bit more advanced capabilities, such as plate solving, but I think it's also available in astrophotography tool, but actually I'm using Sequence Generator Pro. And with Sequence Generator Pro, you can engage in like highly automated capturing. So you can connect your camera, you can connect maybe your filter wheel also, you can learn how to plate solve. These are all, I would say, advanced capabilities of Sequence Generator Pro. I'm not getting into it right now, but if you want to know how Sequence Generator Pro, how it works, I have some videos on that, so I will link them also in the description below. And with that, let's go to the seventh and final tip. The seventh and final tip I want to give you is that as an amateur astrophotographer, you have to learn how to stack and post-process your images. And it will take way too long to discuss this in detail, but I want to give you some general tips that will help you get started. So first of all, stacking actually means that you will end up with a lot of pictures of your deep sky object. So you have to remember that when you are taking a multi-minute exposure of a deep sky object and you are successful, then still the faint light that is coming from that object is very weak. So you will need to take maybe 10, 20, 30, 40, 100 pictures of your deep sky object. And all of those images together, you want to stack those images and you want to combine them into one stacked image that contains the information of all those individual frames. And that is what stacking is all about. And I have a dedicated videos on how to stack, so please check out the description of the video again. And but basically what a lot of people start using, because it is free software, I want to show you, I want to give you this tip, is Deep Sky Stacker. Just download and start to use Deep Sky, Sky Stacker. It's freely available. Just check out my video on where I explain how to start how to do stacking using that program. And what I did not mention actually is that it is also important to take calibration frames. So you have to learn how to take flats, dark and bias frames. Just check that out. I will not get into that right now, but check out the video on stacking and you understand what I mean. And then of course, when you have created this beautiful a stacked picture of your deep sky object, the final step is to further post-process that particular picture. And most often people use either Photoshop or PixInsight. And I think most of the people actually start out using Photoshop. So you can, for instance, download Photoshop Creative Cloud. Yeah, you can have a monthly subscription on that. It costs, of course, a little bit of money, but that will get you started in post-processing your astrophotography pictures. I have some video on how to post-process using Photoshop. And when you want a more advanced program, a lot of people or a lot of amateur astrophotographers that are like several years down the road, they mention that PixInsight is really the program that you should use for your post-processing. So PixInsight, I would say it's not very user-friendly. I'm getting into PixInsight myself. And it has a steep learning curve, I have to say. But it also, it creates beautiful pictures of your deep sky object. It has some very advanced algorithms, I would say, to really bring out all of the details that you want to see in your pictures. So either Photoshop or PixInsight are two very nice programs to use in order to further post-process your images and get that final beautiful picture that you are looking for. That's all I have for you today, guys. So hi folks, we're at the end of the video. I hope you got some value out of it. If you did, please consider giving this video a thumbs up. I would highly appreciate that. And of course, I hope to see you again in one of my other videos on my channel. And until then, I just want to thank you for watching. Clear skies. Bye-bye.